Dum 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 dum. Hi there. Welcome to another episode of The Hobby, part of Story Tiles. And today we are going to look at a particular game called Okko Chronicles. Okko Chronicles is a feudal horror Japanese dungeon crawler, and it is one of my favorite dungeon crawlers, to be honest. The theme really is evocative, and yeah, it plays very intuitive. But as you can see, if you get it right out of the box, it will look approximately something like this. There is no mat, by the way, I have to say. Underneath the board game, this is just one of the neoprene mats that I bought myself. But you will get these tiles and you will get these miniatures, and they're gorgeous miniatures. I mean, when you look at them, they are quite stunning and detailed. But they do have these big ugly bases on them. Now, part of the hobby, of course, is how to sort of maximize your table presence, and today we are going to transform this into something like this. Now, what is different? well, obviously, there are walls now in your game. Let's zoom in a little closer. So these walls, we're going to learn today how to make those. These are cardboard paper, thick paper, sort of dungeon crawling walls, and I've used some artwork that I found on the internet to actually make these and use them in my dungeon crawler to have a more immersive experience. Of course, the miniatures, they are also painted. I didn't paint them up between this little magic trick shot between the previous shot and this one. I basically just switched out a spare miniature that I had with them. But as you can see, the bases have been replaced with acrylic bases, and that allows you to, besides being painted up, obviously, but the acrylic bases allow you to actually see the gorgeous tiles underneath, because when you cover them up like that, you're missing a whole lot of the beautiful artwork that these tiles come with. And the artwork is one of the major points of Okko Chronicles, so I put acrylic bases underneath these. Now, I'm not specifically going to cover how to do acrylic bases. Now, essentially, you have to buy them online and then cut off the plastic bases from the miniatures and glue the painted miniature onto the acrylic bases. And it sounds really simple, and it kind of is. I'll cover that probably in another episode of The Hobby, but for now, I want to concentrate on these walls. So let's go have a look and see what we can find on the big old interweb to create these spiffy little Japanese walls. The first thing that comes to mind is essentially just looking up some Japanese walls, maybe. Let's see what we get. Yeah, this looks actually already pretty much in the range that we're looking for. To see what they're called. They're called shoji. So you could essentially also just refine your search to shoji walls. Yeah, you get pretty much the same results, so it doesn't really matter. But what does matter is that you look at the images specifically, because we do want to be looking at these. Now, what we want are not images like this image up here or these, or anything with perspective, because it just makes it that much harder to copy these kind of walls onto, you know, a frontal view print that we're going to make. Now, we also kind of want to stay away from walls or pictures that are copyrighted. Things like Pinterest never really work because they are too small, but copyrighted ones, and ironically, I'm not seeing any copyrighted ones just yet here. Oh, there's also a lot of Second Life Marketplace ones. Those are for, I think, the video game called Second Life. I'm not exactly sure.
But yeah, those are not really high quality ones that we can really use. Now, mind you, the walls are going to be really small on your board game, but still, you want to have some decent resolution. Oh, for instance, here, Shutterstock. Okay, so Shutterstock is a site where you can buy imagery, and you can see already it's really small. It's 390 pixels by 280, so that's going to give you a really poor resolution. But also, when you look at the images, they also have watermarks on them. Alami is another one. So you can see these watermarks on there, and they're going to show up even really small on your wall. So you basically want to stay away from copyrighted materials or materials that you have to pay for, just because there's enough imagery out there that will suffice. I am going to switch very quickly to a different view because I have some already lined up right here. And in fact, there are ones that I've already used for my walls, and let's see if I can trace back which ones they are. I think maybe, let's have a look. I think it was maybe this one. See, the beauty of Google image search is also that when you look at an image, you not only see the resolution down here, and if the resolution is too low, then the imagery is going to look fuzzy, but you can also see similar images below. So, and then you can just keep on clicking. This one, for instance, I think this is actually the one that I used for some of the walls. Yeah, so let's just go with this. It has a good resolution. It is not a, it says here images may be subject to copyright, but I don't think that this one is hugely influential. And by the way, we're not going to be using the entire image. We're just going to be cutting out a part of this. All right, so what we want to do is we want to download, we want to save this image onto our laptop or MacBook, or in my case, we're just going to copy the image, and then we're going to go to a program where we can manipulate this image more. Now, what I use is Photoshop, and here you can actually see my finished file. Your file is probably not going to look exactly like this. Even if you work in Photoshop, I've had 20 years of working in Photoshop, so I kind of know what I'm doing. But even if you had like a free software program that allows you to manipulate imagery, you could use the image that we just copied and cut away there, because it's really a very simple process. So for now, I am just going to I'm going to hide this. And what we're going to start with is just a blank canvas. I have the margins for printing lined out here, but you could just, place it safely within the middle of the canvas. Okay, so I just made a box that has the dimensions of the typical space of a board game grid, a dungeon crawler specifically. In this case, it is roughly four centimeters or 40 millimeters. You can see it here on the right-hand side. 40 millimeters is, well, so an inch in American measurements, an inch is 2.54 to be exact, centimeters. So that would be roughly 25.4 millimeters. I've made them a little bit bigger just because the base of a miniature is roughly, I think, 33 millimeters, and we want the walls to be slightly higher than the miniatures, just to give it that idea that they're actually walking through a dungeon, or in this case, a Japanese castle. So I've made this to be roughly 4 centimeters, or now I have to calculate in inches. That would be 1.4 maybe inches, but you can adjust it. And exactly, that's what we're also going to do here. We are going to just adjust the length, first of all, because we're going to make a whole wall of Japanese printed screens. But we're also going to make multiples of these, so we can just print out one sheet and then and be done with it. Actually, we're going to print out two sheets because we want a front and a back to each of these walls. All right, so then we're going to put the image that we just found. We're going to put it here in my case, Photoshop. We're going to load it up, and we can see already that there's obviously a lot of stuff here that we're not going to use. I'm going to make it a little bit bigger so we can more easier see where we're going to cut. But essentially what you want to do is you want to get rid of everything except the door. Now, I'm going to use a marquee to grab the portion of the door that I want. If you don't have a marquee tool in your program, whatever you use, you can also just cut away or erase the image around it. I try not to do that within Photoshop because it makes it sloppier. But yeah, you could just like basically just delete everything around it or paint over it with a white color. It doesn't really matter as long as you basically get rid of everything that you don't want. And this is going to take me a long time to just do it with an eraser. So I'm just going to use the marquee tool because for me, that's actually a little bit handier. Now, there are some tools that I use in Photoshop that you might be familiar with if you're also a Photoshop user. For instance, inverse of selection. So now I've what I've selected here, I've turned it around and I've selected everything else but the door. And I can just press delete and it deletes everything around it. Again, however you do this, it's kind of up to you, but this is how I do it. Now I have a door. It's not perfectly straightened, so we could like straighten it out like a little bit like that. I also want to make it a little bit lighter. Now, almost every software program has some kind of tool that allows you to make imagery lighter or darker or more colorful or less colorful. I use levels within Photoshop. It gives me more control to basically say like, okay, I want a darker. In this case, I do not want a darker. All right, I think this is fine for now. And yeah, we want it to be as straight as possible. All right, so I'm gonna resize this. I'm gonna make it approximately the size that we want it to be. It doesn't have to be perfect because we're going to be cutting these out later anyway, but we do want to prevent any kind of white lines from appearing in between the elements. A good way of doing that, by the way, is grabbing the template box that we've created to give us the right measurements. And we could essentially just color that box, because the black shading is going to work anyway in our favor. It's better than white because white stands out when you make walls like these. Right, now we're going to copy and paste it next to each other. If you want to be really fancy, you can see that there's light coming out here and looks really duplicated here. You could, if you wanted to, flip it and then you just have like two sections of one wall and there just happens to be light down here, maybe because, you know, there's a lantern on the other side or something like that. All right, you can fancy it up and spend as much time as you want with this. I'm going to move a little bit faster so this doesn't turn into an extremely long video. Okay, so you can see like that this, for instance, is a little bit thicker than on this side. And that's fine. It really is. Like, I don't want to be spending, you know, days doing this. You don't want to be spending days doing this. This is something that should be fun. And when it starts not being fun anymore, then you know you're spending too much time on it. These dark walls are all nice and dandy, but when we're walking around, you know, a feudal castle or building that's not particularly prone to horrific happenings, then we just want the regular shoji walls. All right, so I'm going to look here. Let's see what we can find for lighter walls. This looks nice. We're just going to grab this one because this one already looks really light. It looks really nice. It looks a little modern, but that's okay. You won't really notice when you're playing the game. There's a channel, Meet Me at the Table by Berndt, who does paint-throughs, and his motto is always keep it simple. Just get things to the table when he's painting miniatures. I am going to do the same thing, but in terms of these walls, we're just going to keep it simple. So what do we want to do? I kind of like this layered approach here, these walls. So we're just going to copy this whole section. And mind you, this is up to your own taste. You can't make any mistakes with this kind of exercise. Because, you know, we're hobbying. Hobbying is fun. I love making stuff like this. This is, for me, part of the whole gaming experience. Not just painting miniatures, not just, you know, playing the game right out of the box, but getting that personalized experience that just makes it fun. Cool. This looks pretty good, right? Okay, so what we want to do is we want to be able to have the size of this square, this rectangle. It's going to pop up here. Because when we for instance, have a miniature that fits on a space, this space is going to be multiplied by a number of times, like maybe two or three times, to form a hallway. Well, like when you think of the tiles that these miniatures are walking on, sometimes these walls are like three miniature spaces wide, or maybe two, or maybe five. Like, they can be of various lengths. And so we want those walls to be of various lengths, and we don't want to like cut off a wall halfway, because that just looks bad, right? We want them to be uniform enough so that we can have sections of one, we can have two, or we can have three or four or five of these kind of walls. So that's why I'm using this little guide to sort of like measure how long, or how, yeah, basically how long this wall is going to be. I'm going to give it a different color though, because we do want it to stand out against the white. Well, and give it red for now. All right, so we want this wall to basically kind of look like these doors down here. So we're just going to make them maybe longer. And I think actually this is perfect right here. Yeah, let's make it a little bit there. Because now what we have is when we just need one small wall, we can cut it out right here, and we can have this partition of three panels as one wall. If we want it to be two, we would grab two, etc., etc. So now we have the perfect length for this image, and now we're just going to duplicate it again. And okay, now we've got our walls. Now, this is a perfectly good sheet. You can really nicely play a game of Forbidden Fortress or Okko Chronicles or any other feudal Japanese game that has sort of like tiles in there that you have characters wandering around on and you need walls for. These are perfectly fine. What I've done, however, with my own walls is I've decorated these walls a little bit. Now, what are these images? Okay, so let's have a look. What these images are, traditional Japanese imagery. So you see here like a battle scene. There's some guy warding off a demon of sorts. And then there's some geishas near a riverfront. And down here on the darker portions of the walls, they are more, there's a different style, but it's just darker and more, mysterious imagery. And yeah, let's go have a look and see what we can find on the internet. Okay. Here I've already typed in old Japanese art. And you can actually see some of the artwork that I have already used. This one, for instance. And yeah, we just do the same thing. We copy this image or we download it, and then we go back to our work in progress. And here we go. Now you can see that there's a border around this. I would erase that border because the color scheme just doesn't match. And now we can do it same as that we did earlier. We resize it. And now we can fit it right over the rice paper part of the screen. We can also just go full on across the entirety of the shoji wall itself if we wanted to, like that. And again, with these doors that we made earlier, these lighter doors, we want to make sure that once we cut these pieces of wall, that we don't cut like halfway through an image. So we have to resize them. We have to squeeze them in a little bit to make them like maybe even like this. Yeah, this looks, see, and it doesn't really matter for the artwork. Like the artwork looks just as fine like this as it did all stretched out in its original form. So we're going to keep it like this. Now you can copy and paste this section, but we can also just go back and look for some other artwork. Now what you might want to do, and this requires a little bit more experience, is you might want to tinker with the coloring, the hue of the image. Now, that, like I said, this kind of requires a little bit more expertise. Like I said, it requires a little bit more expertise. So you have to like know what you're doing, but you could like change the color a little bit to match the color of the other two ones. There. All right, this looks pretty on par with the other colors. All right, so yeah, you can tinker with this as much as that you want to, but this looks good enough for me. Now, we can put some imagery on here. I'm going to quickly go do that, and then we're going to come back and we're going to go to the next step. All right, so I am quite happy now with how this looks. And now we are going to print them out.
All right, so we have now printed out our walls. I have done so on 200 grams paper, which is quite thick. You can do it on any thickness of paper that you want, as long as it actually processes through your printer. If it gets too bulky, then maybe your printer can't handle it. If it gets too flimsy, not a problem. Then you can just grab any kind of cereal box, and we can cut it open. And now we have perfectly good cardboard material to glue these walls on. I will not be doing this because obviously, like I said earlier, I have thick enough paper, but yeah, you could essentially just glue it on there. Make sure that the creases of the cardboard don't overlap with the art, so maybe cut them out first and then glue them onto the cardboard. Whatever doesn't fit, you put onto the next piece of cardboard. You know, this is a cereal box. You probably eat enough cereal to actually have enough of these boxes that you can keep. But yeah, so this would actually provide some nice thickness for your walls later on. But yeah, so let's get to it. Let's stick these together, and then we'll see how far we get. All right, so as you can see, it was a little bit more work to just glue it on and measure exactly, holding it maybe up against the light, where one side stops and where the other side begins, and to just sort of align that perfectly. And of course, it also depends on the shapes that you've been using. I see that here, actually, for instance, one of these shapes I've made too big, so it's actually overlapping here, so that will be cut off, but you know, it is what it is. You don't have to use all of them. If you feel like this is too much of an aberration, then you could just basically just leave this whole piece out. That's fine. So yeah, it's a little bit of it's a little bit messy work, but it will pass for now. This is my second batch, so I'm actually quite okay with this as this goes. All right, while we let this dry, I just want to give you a little pro tip that's really easy to accomplish. Now, these are the tiles for the game, and the tiles are gorgeous. And of course, when they're lying next to each other, they make like interesting little landscapes. But when you're looking at them, you're not typically looking at them just from the top. You're also looking at them from an angle. And what you can see from an angle is that you see the lighter cardboard material along the edge of the tile. Let's see if I can zoom in a little bit. See, you can see it here. Now, what I've done with this tile, the one underneath it, for instance, is that I have made it black. But it's also very little effort to actually just make this black. What we do is we just take a marker, take the edge, we take the edge of the marker itself, and we just gently rub over it. There you go. All right, so this is basically what I do with all my tiles. And you can even do it with tokens. Tokens that have a black edge to them. This one, for instance, has a white edge, so the regular cardboard color does not jar as much. But if it were just all black like this, then you might want to consider also making it black on the sides. So this should be dry enough. I am going to cut it out along the lines, so we have strips, and then I'm going to just partition it at random to create larger sections and smaller sections all across the board, and hopefully they will turn out all right. So there's a little bit of an edge there. See that where it sort of mismatched with the top of it. That is okay. That doesn't bother me too much. This actually may be a little bit more obtrusive, so I might actually cut this off. And yes, it cuts a little bit away from this side, but because it is just pure white, it takes a little bit away from. See, and this is less obtrusive than, you know, the white in there. Let's have a look at some other pieces here. All right. Now all we have to do is we got to make them stand, because like this, they're not going to stand. And I have used various other means of, plastic holders to actually hold them up like that. But none of them are actually as, because see, the thickness, for instance, of this one is not enough that it actually supports a thin home brewed wall. This is really just for like more thicker cardboard, cardstock walls and stuff. So yeah, this one won't fit in there. And the same actually with little standee plastic holders where you put like a standee, and the standees are just of a thicker quality. So this won't do. So we're just going to make our own little stands, and that's what we're going to use those for. We're going to basically recreate this. So we're going to have like these little, I don't know exactly what to call them, pegs or something, or just cardboard feet. And all it requires is that we essentially we cut a little bit in each part of the paper to have like this little area where we can then shove them in and create this little cross foot. And it doesn't even have to be like straight. It can be like this, because this will still make it stand. There's enough. These walls are not heavy. They're very flimsy. So you can actually just have them still stand here and no problem whatsoever. Yeah. So we're going to cut these up and we're going to put them in there. And then we're going to see the final results, because this is it. This is how simple it really is. So now we're back at our game table with a few of the previously made walls set up. As you can see, the walls for this particular game, again, this is Okko Chronicles, the tiles are very dark. And so like in the most clearest of tiles, it can be sometimes a little bit of a puzzle of, okay, so where do I go? Like, okay, do I go through here? No, wait, there's a wall. Do I go through here? Yeah, there's a door. Now, if you just put up a wall, then of course it becomes instantly clear. Like, now, okay, now I know that there's a wall right there, right? And in fact, you could just not have walls and just indicate where there are doors with these kind of self-made standees. That would work just as well. I like to essentially create the walls. I have to make more of them, obviously, but then you get more of that 3D dimensional aspect to your dungeon crawl, which just looks generally nice. Also, it takes up very little space in your game box. You can even flatten them all out. You can flatten the feet and everything. You don't have to futz around with standee plastic feet. Now that is it. I would say keep on exploring new ways to immerse yourself deeper into your dungeon crawl or whatever board game it may be. This was the tutorial for how to make these shoji walls for feudal Japanese board games. But of course you could do the same thing with typical standard dungeon crawls. That's it for me today. Happy crafting, and keep on exploring.